Media recognition from Bloomberg, Reuters, Recycling Trade Publications. Patented process for 100% recovery of critical metals, including cobalt, lithium, nickel, manganese, aluminum. American Manganese is focused on recycling lithium-ion batteries for electric vehicles. American Manganese trades on the TSX Venture, AMY, the U.S., AMYZF, and Frankfurt 2AM. For more information, visit AmericanManganeseInc.com or phone me, Larry Ray, at 778-574-4444.
You're listening to HowStreet.com Radio, available online at TalkDigitalNetwork.com. Welcome to HowStreet.com Radio, the online source for market opinions. Here is Jim Goddard.
My guest is Tim Cyclesman Wood, editor of Cycles News and Views on Cyclesman.com. Welcome back to the show, Tim.
Jim, thanks again for having me, and happy birthday to you.
Well, thank you very much. Tim, the U.S. official inflation rate is a little over 6%. No interest rate hikes to quell it, but I've done some calculations based on the way they used to calculate inflation back in the 70s when they included the price of homes and fuel and taxes. The real inflation rate is more like 12%. Would you agree with that?
Well, I haven't done the calculations. The inflation rate, look, there is definitely inflation. There is no question about that. I'm not denying that, and I hope I haven't sent the message. I don't think I have that I am denying that. I'm just saying that the inflation that we are seeing is not a function of an expanding, growing, recovering economy. I also maintain that it's not a function of the money printing. It's a function of shortages, supply chain issues, and that sort of thing. But yes, the inflation rate, I mean, one trip to the grocery store, I mean, go buy a car part or anything. I mean, you know, lumber, it doesn't matter. Yes, we're seeing inflation. But there is a difference as to why. And the subtle perception, I think, that we're being told is that it is because of, or at least my perception, what I'm hearing from mainstream, is that it's a result of the money printing and maybe an element of the recovering economy. And I'm saying that's not true. To your point, kind of, proof that the inflation is not from economic growth or from the money printing. If it was and the Fed was really so concerned about the inflation, I mean, they're talking about it, but if they're really so, or they act like they are, is what I'm trying to say. And that's an element of, that's the salesmanship. That's selling it to the market. But if they were genuinely concerned about that, then why not jump in front of it? Raise rates a half a point. Just, you know, if it's such a concern, then jump out there and do it. Quit talking about it. Raise rates. They're not going to raise rates because they can't. They can't. Looking at my Fed model, going back to 1943, there's no precedence for them to raise rates in the current environment. They did it one time in similar circumstances, looking at it from the model perspective. It was in the mid 90s, and we were in a true, you know, a growth period. We were in the middle of the dot-com bubble, not in the middle of a environment where, you know, where they're passing stimulus bills. What we're seeing is, you know, the inflation, it is strictly a function, I think, of supply chain shortages. And to your point, if we've seen the greatest inflation, I saw a blurb on the news about the inflation rate being the highest since like the early 80s, 82, 84, whatever it was. If that's true, again, why don't they jump out there and raise rates? And it's because the market can't handle it. Does anyone remember December 2018? They were going to raise, and they did make some raises, and the market took it for a little while, and then in December 2018, they made that final cut, and the market said, no, you're not. And it started to stumble. And they can't raise here on this zombie economy. There's no way.
Mm-hmm. You call it a zombie economy. Why?
Because there is no real economic growth. What we're seeing is it's a function of the government spending. Remember prior to the corona bug back in 2018, 19, We looked at, under the hood, at the economic growth, at the expansion of consumer debt, at automotive sales. We looked at all sorts of data. And the economy was the growth, the jobs growth rate, the real jobs growth rate, not what we were being told. It was all contracting then. Since the corona fiasco and the, you know, the expansion of debt that we've seen, you know, in the wake of that, we're struggling to get back to that point. That's our benchmark, and we're not even there. On the back of everything they've done, we haven't made it back to that point. And so from that perspective, I'm calling it a zombie economy. Our biggest risk here is not of an of continued inflation. Our biggest risk here, in my opinion, is of a debt-driven deflationary collapse. And that is what they're fighting. And they're trying to sell the public in the marketplace on the inflation when it's exactly the opposite.
Now, of course, when you talk about debt and deflation, the government solution is to run up more debt. How does that end?
Well, let's talk about that. The money printing. As for the money printing, it's not money printing. And I mean, simplistically, from my perspective, I mean, this is, everybody's got an opinion, this is my perspective, and I think I'm right. But it's not money printing, it's debt printing, it's global debt enslavement. It's all a misperception. Let me give you a scenario. Your neighbor, your friend, his household economy is not functioning economically. And so he takes his credit card and uses it to bridge the gap. But that's still not enough. His economy is still not, his little microeconomy is still not functioning. So he gets another credit card and he uses it to bridge that gap and to make the payment on the first credit card. But then that's not enough. And so he does it again and again and again. And he tells you, he says, Jim, it's just money printing. I'm just printing money. I'm just going to the bank. I'll take them this little plastic card and they give me a cash advance and I go, well, it's just money printing. You'd tell him he's an idiot. What's the difference? It's the same thing. It's not money printing. It's debt enslavement. It's a debt expansion program. And that also is what I'm saying about it being a zombie economy. That's what we're living on here. And, you know, the long bond, it made another point. The long bond, it was a long-term cycle low. When I say long bond, I'm looking at the 30-year. There was a long-term cycle low in March. Since then, long-term rates, the 30-year rate, it's been trending lower, generally lower. That's not inflationary. So interest rates is telling us a different story than the inflationary line that we're hearing. And again, I'm not saying there's not inflation. I'm saying it's not from monetary economic growth. It's from shortages. So there's a difference. And yes, in the short run, you know, since summer, since the reverse repo operations began, we've also seen a spike up in the short-term rates, but now they're coming under pressure. And if the trend with the longer-term rates continue moving down, if that's something doesn't happen to change that, we're going to continue to see increased pressure on the short end, which means it, again, that's not a sign of inflation. So we're hearing one thing, but I think the reality is the other. And this is all part of the talk to try to convince the marketplace of inflation / recovery. And it's, like I said, zombie economy.
Now, I'm thinking, okay, if you're saying it's supply chain, but people are enjoying higher prices for their product, even though there's less of it, and they're seeing, some people are seeing record profits for their companies.
Sure.
Why, when the supply chain problem is solved, why should I produce enough of anything? Why don't I just permanently curtail my shipments of a product and enjoy the higher prices and make less?
Well, maybe that's a new wave of the future. I don't know. But there's another aspect to this, because I'm seeing it in myself. I'm hearing it from others. And I have said, I think at some point, maybe I said it to you, I think we've talked about this on the air, but this is an additional, these prices, in addition to the zombie economy and the recovery and that is debt induced, if you will, these higher prices serve as an additional burden, an additional tax, however you want to say it, on the economy. And I'm seeing it with people. I'm hearing it myself. I have gone to the store and I look at, okay, give you a couple examples. I've used this before. I needed pine straw for, my flower beds. People use pine straw in this area. And at first you couldn't get any. Well, the coronavirus didn't shut down. I mean, the pine straw did not fall out of the trees. It was a function of supply chain. And you see it with a lot, you know, with everything if you just think about it. And then when you could find it, they wanted $8 a bale versus $2 a bale. Well, I'm not giving you $8 a bale. To hell with it. I'm just refusing. And I'm seeing that, I'm hearing that from other people. I've heard people say they were going to do a little project around the house. They went to get lumber and they saw the price of lumber and said, I'm not doing it. And so, more and more, I think we're seeing now that these higher prices are going, it is the death knell to the zombie economy, in my opinion. So I don't think the answer to your question is, I don't think ultimately that's sustainable because the economy can't support the higher prices.
We'll have more with Tim Cyclesman Wood right after this.
Don't miss out. Stay informed. Receive the HowStreet.com weekly recap with thought-provoking podcasts, radio, and articles delivered to your inbox. Sign up for the HowStreet.com weekly recap on our homepage at HowStreet.com.
Welcome back. We're speaking with Tim Cyclesman Wood. Do you think the stock market is peaking out right now and maybe has another couple of months of life left in it, and then we're going to see a major correction, maybe a collapse?
I think that there are cracks, we tried to set up in August. It didn't quite materialize, and there are cracks now. That's something I'm watching, writing the letter as we speak, working on the letter this week, and I'm monitoring that in the short-term updates, but yes, there are cracks. Does it stick? Is this it? That remains to be seen. That's what we're watching daily. And once that structure, I've said that before, the structure is going to tell us. Once it's in place, firmly in place, bada-bing, and confirmed, then, yeah, I think the risk is going to be extremely high. You know, you asked me several weeks ago, or maybe I think it was two interviews ago, about Bitcoin or something, cryptos, and I said, yeah, that we'd seen I had an intermediate term sell signal that week on crypto. I think that that's a crack. We're seeing some cracks in some of the commodities and some of the commodity related indexes. We're seeing some cracks in some of the equity indexes and some of the sectors. So yes, there are cracks out there. The question comes back to, how well can they manage this or continue to manage this? And that's part of the sales job that we're seeing with this inflation thing, because the inflation paints the picture that everything is okay, that we're expanding, it's growth, it's, you know, that we can raise rates because the economy is good. But we're not going to do it now, we're going to do it next year. You know, well, I'm saying, well, hell, do it now. If you're really that concerned, jump out there and raise them now and see what happens. And so it's part of the sales job to keep this thing going. How well can he manage that? I don't know. But when the structure sets up and it cracks, I think the thing that we face is, like some of these stocks we've seen, you know, you wake up one morning and it's down 20%. And I think that is literally the type of risk here, because it's been built as such a house of cards. And in the end, I think that all the asset that, you know, I've said that I think all asset prices are going to peak in general proximity and go down together. In the end, I think that's what happens. You have a collapse in asset prices, but the mountain of debt will remain. And that mountain of debt is going to be, you know, it's going to be a global enslavement of the nations, the people, you know, to the central banks, to the money masters. And I suspect that may be part of what we're seeing here, the talk about, you know, the reset. It's really, when you look at what's going on from that perspective, it's really a pretty dire situation with this bubble.
Now, so many financial institutions have had very healthy profits, and most of them, if not all of them, plan major share buybacks. I can see them buying back their shares. Then if the market drops, them begging the government for bailouts, or for us consumers, bail-ins, where they can dip into your bank account to balance their books.
Yes, and I had a friend from overseas send me some information. I think it was, don't hold me to this, but because I don't all the way remember. But it was, well, I don't even want to say, but it was one of the foreign banks where they had, I mean, I read the documentation from the bank, where they can actually take people's, literally take people's savings with the bail-ins.
Yes.
And I don't think that's right for a minute. Nobody's going to bail you out if you go under. It's all about the, you know, it's like George Carlin said, it's a big club and you ain't in it. So no, I don't agree that is, I don't think that's right. But that plays into what I said before. This debt, they're taking the bait that it's money printing. Oh, it's money printing. They got this, you know, the Greenspan put or whatever they called it. Put, you know, the Fed's got this. They're backstopping it. Money printing. No, it's a mountain of debt. And if you go to the Fed site and actually look, how is it worded? A total, I can't remember what the word is, but anyways, it says total federal debt : public debt or something to that effect. So what that's telling you is it's yours. In the end, the taxpayer is going to be stuck with it. It's not just going to go away when all the other asset prices collapse. The debt's still going to be there. And that's part of what people aren't seeing.
What happens when all these treasury bills come due? Who's going to pay that money out?
I don't know. I assume that the federal government will have to honor those bills, and maybe that's by printing yet more money. I don't know.
And of course, they haven't actually printed any cash. It's all just done on a computer. You add a few more numbers or change the decimal point. You haven't actually had a printing press cranking out dollars. People have that image that the mints in Canada and the U.S. and Britain are cranking out extra currency. They're not.
Right. That's exactly right. And I had a friend in an overseas bank try to take some money out of a bank, and he said it was almost impossible. I mean, he had to get ugly to get money out of his bank. I think he told me he had to threaten to get a lawyer to get some of his money out of the bank. He wanted some cash on hand. And so they don't have it. So anyway, I mean, it's just all part of the Ponzi scheme, if you will. You know, like I said, last interview we talked about how, and I don't know if I explained it well this time, but you know, we talked about how there is a difference between the inflation, of course. I've never said there's not inflation because, like I said, I go to the grocery store like everybody else. But it's the point behind it, what's really driving it. And that, I think, is the key. And if you look at, if you just stand back and look, interest rates is telling us one thing and the mainstream is telling us something else. And the something else is the narrative to support the house of cards, in my opinion.
Tim, thank you so much for chatting with us.
Thank you for having me.
My guest has been Tim Cyclesman Wood, editor of Cycles News and Views on cyclesman.com. If you have any questions for Tim, we'll ask that question for you if you send it to info@howstreet.com, our YouTube channel, Talk Digital Network. Find us on Twitter @HowStreet. We're also on Facebook. I'm Jim Goddard. Thank you for listening.
Comments made on HowStreet.com radio are an expression of opinion only and should not be construed in any matter whatsoever as recommendations to buy or sell any financial instrument at any time. Available online at TalkDigitalNetwork.com, HowStreet.com radio is a production of HowStreet Media Incorporated.